I welcome everyone to this video. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Do you hear that sound? That's rain. Yeah. It's actually raining in California. Hasn't rained like this in over 2 years. So this is like music to our ears here. That's fantastic. Wow. Love it. Welcome again to this video, which is, I call it, Triggering the Wow, Full Stop in the Now. Triggering the Wow, Full Stop in the Now. Or you could say, Triggering the Wow, Full Stop in the Wow. Full Stop in the Burn. So we trigger the wow, okay? We trigger the spiritual wow. This is incredible news, good news. We call good news the gospel. It's good news. We trigger really good news beyond anything we can imagine. It's just tremendous good news, wow. And then we full stop in this, the now of the wow. Full stop in the now of the wow. Trigger the wow, full stop in the now of the wow. Now, in A Course in Miracles, Jesus spoke about what he's doing. What he said is, this is really mind training. What we're supposed to do is mind training. Now, I never really understood this. What is he talking, mind training? Well, I do now. I do understand it. This morning, I had a tremendous wow. And then I work to stay in that, the now of the wow. Stay in the now of the wow. And I could see how the mind tries to, very cleverly, tries to shift off of it. And it's like a tremendous struggle and battle. And it says, wow, how tricky the mind is. It's amazing how tricky it is. This is what's called mind training, is to train our mind to not slip away like that. Not slip away from the truth, actually. So it is mind training. What we're doing in these videos is mind training, meditation, contemplation, mind training. It's basically the same as all spiritual techniques are some sort of mind training. They're all similar enough that we don't need to do any comparative religion, comparative practice sort of scheme. We don't need to get caught up in that at all. That's a trap. What we need to do is practice this full stop mode, which is what I've been doing in this phase four video. Since we got into phase four here, I've been relentlessly practicing so you can practice along and get the feel for this practice. It is very successful practice, actually. But the results, it's like you're reinvesting. Make money, reinvest. So you say, where's the money? It's all reinvested. And at some point, you have this massive amount of money because you've reinvested it wisely. So what we do is we continually trigger a deeper wow with our success, and then we work to stabilize in the now of that wow. So we keep struggling every day. Every day is an ordeal. But we're reinvesting our success in deeper and deeper, more and more profound wow. More and more profound. And this is what works. This is what works. So we're not looking for, you know, spiritual powers, cities, spiritual powers. We're not looking for that at all. We're not looking to go write a book and say, you know, I have some conceptual clarity about something. We're not looking for that at all. We're only looking to reinvest our progress in deeper progress. This is what's called the fast path, fast tracking. Now, certainly we see all these people writing books and attending symposiums, conferences, seminars. All these people's the spiritual buzz, you know, that they're out doing all these stuff, going public with what they say they know, think they know. And here we are, just in anonymity, grinding away every day. Oh, another wow. I have to struggle so much to try and full stop in the now of the wow. Full stop in the wow of the now. Full stop in the now of this wow. Full stop in the now of this wow. Like that. Full stop in the now of this wow. And so, and we're like down and struggling, and we don't, you know, anonymous, totally anonymous, and nobody pays attention. But what I'm saying here is this is the fast path. This is the fast track. The other stuff is very slow. Too slow, actually. Too slow. Too slow. Stalls out. So what we're doing is we're practicing dropping conceptuality. Full stop is means dropping conceptuality around the now. It means being in the now of this wow. And the wow is a trigger. The wow is a trigger of truth, a truth trigger. And we see it. We see it. And it's, oh my gosh, I'm present in this truth. And we practice full stop in the now of this wow. Non-conceptual. We just keep going back to the wow, just as it is, the presence. Not requiring any conceptuality. Other than the trigger, we might say we'll trigger to help us out. So phase four is the fast track. It's difficult to reach phase four because so many of us get caught up in conceptualization. No matter what we know, we have to drop conceptualization. Drop the mental constructs. So that we can go beyond words and feel and experience, be not just experience, but experiencing, just pure experiencing, with no thought needed, no thinking or thought needed at all. So the wow is when we recognize something that doesn't need any thought, it's self-evident, it's just, I'm here. That's it. And then we practice full stop in the now of this wow. And again, this is what people around the world throughout history have practiced. Struggled to practice. And we're just continuing that great tradition. We don't have to try and tie it into anything else because that's a conceptual tie-in. It's all basically the same. Same. You don't need to be a master of all techniques, historically or anything like that. You just need to do it right now. Keep the conceptual shell from forming around this wow. The conceptual cocoon, because then you're embalming yourself. This morning I practiced already for several hours, and I'm just now sharing this with the world. So let's say once again, we're reinvesting the progress we've made into more strenuous, deeper progress. It's like someone who's very fit and they go out for a longer run. So at the end of the run, they're really tired. But each time they do this, they run more strenuous exercise. They get stronger and stronger and stronger. But you might look at them and every day they're like, wow, I need to rest. I'm so tired. I just really ran. I just ran so up mountains and up and down mountains. I'm so tired today. And they're not, you know, showing off anything. They're not saying, look how fit I am. No. They're using their fitness to get into even more fit instead of going on the stage saying, look how fit I am. Stay off the stage as much as possible. stay off the stage. That's the fast track. So if you're meek and humble and lowly and anonymous and you're just reinvesting your momentum in greater momentum, then you are on the fast track. You're phase four, basically. If you can get with phase four comes from phase three, and phase three, actually all the phases you're reinvesting as much as possible, but in phase four you're really very intense triggers of truth, very intense. When in doubt, be silent, right? Try to say as little as possible. Again, be meek, be unassuming, be humble. It's a mood of repentance, saying I have a severe continuity problem. I have great difficulty evaporating this continuity fear. My mind keeps pulling me away. That was a very severe problem. So let's not be boastful. Let's not be bragging. Let's be patient, because after the practice, you'll say, where's the progress? You just have to be patient. Now, here's the secret. The secret is you practice this full stop, triggering the wow, full stop in the now, the wow. As you practice watching your thoughts and training your thoughts, no, that's not it, and dropping your thoughts, practice dropping. You see something, recognize it, drop it. Recognize it, drop it. It's very similar in practice to what's been going on in the world before. And just by doing this, just by practicing, it's guaranteed, as you get better at this, that new wows will come up just spontaneously to trigger. It's within you. It will spontaneously happen. For instance, this morning, as I was in somewhere, just waking up and sort of dozing on a Sunday morning, this scenario came up where I was on this house trailer or something like that, or some sort of red bus living space, like a trailer. I remember it was all red. Painted red, and for some reason everybody was like in a trailer park. Everybody else had these vehicles that we lived in. Yeah. And for some reason, I felt like I was asked to climb on top of this, up on the roof of this, and nobody had really done that before, really, or at least it wasn't well known. It wasn't something that was done, really. And I went up the side of it. I remember putting my foot on some pipe or something and then grabbing hold of the roof somehow and pulling myself up the roof. I said, wow. And then I remember just thinking that, I don't think I'll be able to get down from here because something broke when I was trying to get up there. It was just like going to be very difficult to get down. And so I got up on the roof of this. And it was completely flat. And there was all these, like you see sometimes galvanized sheet metal, it seems like there's all these pieces of metal that have just been pressed, squished into the sheet all together, just all these little pieces. And that's what it looked like. Like everything had been completely flattened. All these used to be lumps of metal or something had been completely flattened in this totally flat sheet. And I got up there on the roof, and I just said, wow, I don't think I could get down. And then it came into my mind, where I am, there is no down. Where I am, there is no down. And then this just triggered this tremendous wow, because I tacitly, inherently got it. And I knew that I got it. Where I am, there is no down. There is no down at all. And then immediately I went into my spiritual practice, which shows you why it's so important to do practice, practice, practice. So instead of saying, hey, I just realized, you know, this the non-dual condition and blah, blah, blah. I said, no, no. Okay, immediately into my spiritual practice, full stop in the now. Full stop. Immediately realized I just had a tremendous wow trigger, super profound. Immediately went into, okay, I'm just going to sit here, and all I'm going to do is practice the full stop in this. That's it. And then for hours I was practicing that. Fruitfully, but the mind was coming in all different angles and directions, you know. And so immediately I kept my poise. Now, I wouldn't have climbed up on this roof if I didn't have tremendous confidence and experience in practicing. Somehow knowing that I could go right into the practice like that. Otherwise, I would have been overwhelmed and freaked out, for sure. So this shows you that as you practice and practice and practice and get better and better and better, automatically you will take on greater challenges. You will feel confident enough to take on greater challenges. Because you know wherever you go, you will right away, when you feel, oh, the wow has been triggered, okay, full stop in the wow, start practicing. Just like that. So this path is super successful, very, very successful. This practice is very successful. And yet you don't think about the success. You see, full stop in the wow. No, you're not, thoughts of success? No. Oh, I really succeeded. No. Drop it. Drop it. That's a concept. That's a concept. Concept of attainment. It's a concept. Where I am, there is no down. There is no down at all. Where I am, there is no down. No down whatsoever. Full stop in that. So, when you have a trigger of a wow, recognize it. Immediately know you have a severe continuity problem about this. Immediately go into your practice of full stop, of watching your thoughts and dropping them, dropping them, dropping them. So what happens is you'll cleverly start to get pulled into a train of thought, and then you recognize, well, it's a train of thought, drop it. Don't work with the train of thought to bring it to a resolution, just drop it. This isn't full stop in the now of this wow, so just drop it. So I would say that practicing dropping thoughts is super important. And this is, you know, fundamental to all, you know, passive meditation, contemplation is, well, that's a thought, drop it. But what we're doing is a little different because we're triggering this wow. There's some practices where just whatever thought arises, drop it. Oh, that's a thought. Doesn't mean anything. That's a thought. Okay, that's fine. This is very similar to what we're doing. There's several ways to climb a mountain, but it's very similar. What we're doing is we have this tremendous realization that where I am, there is no down. Where I am, there is no down. And we're feeling this. And we know this is true. And then we practice not having any thoughts about it. So that's a very rigorous, because immediately we want to start thinking about it and conceptualizing and patting ourselves on the back. What a recognition. What an attainment. Wow, that's great. You know? Don't entertain any thoughts about it. Don't entertain any thoughts about it. As soon as you entertain thoughts, it turns into a train of thought, and that spins into scenarios, and before you know it, you've lost the presence, the feeling, lost the wow. Stay with the wow. Just stay with the wow. Super important to stay with the wow. I call it staggered mind. Stay with the staggered mind. Don't try to conceptualize the staggered mind. Don't try to stabilize it through conceptuality, or thinking, the thoughts, or train of thoughts. Just let it calm down naturally. Just calm down naturally, instead of trying to calm yourself down through conceptual structuring. And then you watch the play of the mind, you see the dualistic. Just practice instead of patting yourself on the back. Oh, I saw that, drop that one too. Oh, I see how it's so dualistic, and drop that. Full stop in the wow. And now this wow. So, by practicing, you will start to see it. And say, oh, yeah, and get the hang of it. Where I am, there is no down. There is no down. This is just light. I was worried about, well, how am I going to get down from this roof? And then I realized where I am, right now, where I am, there isn't any down at all. There's no down. So there's no thought of how do I get down? How do I get up? How do I get down? There's a down, there's an up. There's no down, there's no up. Where I am, there is no down. It is just this perfect, flat smoothness. There is no down at all. Now, by full stop in the now of this wow, we also mean that we're not looking for something else. We're not looking for bliss. Now, bliss certainly will come from this. I realize, of course, this is the key to bliss. But I didn't start saying, well, where's the bliss? Where's the bliss? No, drop it. Where's the bliss? Drop it. That's not full stop. That's searching. So full stop means you're not searching for anything. You're already where you are, and you're accepting where you are. Okay, I'm sitting on this roof, where I am, there is no downness. I'm sitting in the where I am, there is no downness. I'm sitting in that. I'm abiding in that. I'm just abiding in it. I'm not searching for anything. I'm not searching for anything. I'm not anticipating anything. Not expecting anything, anticipating, searching, thinking, evaluating, celebrating, nothing. I'm just abiding and not moving my mind, trying not to move at all. It's like climbing a huge mountain. Let's say you're climbing Annapurna or something, really dangerous mountain, difficult. And you're going through the glacier field, and you go across a crevasse, and you know, really important, you've got to cross it. Now, do you start thinking, oh, wow, I'm closer to the top. I wonder what it's going to be like on the top. No. You just, right where you are, you say, hey, this is where I am right now. And I just made this tremendous traverse here. Successfully, and this is super important, and I'm just going to feel how it feels to successfully have made this traverse. I'm not thinking about the top of the mountain. Now you know that this crossing, this traverse, is an integral part of reaching the top, of course, but you're not thinking about what's the view from the top going to be like. Right? You're not thinking about it. Oh, I'm going to have some peak experience soon. No. The peak experience is what you're having right now. For you right now, this is a peak experience. Where I am, there is no down. That's a peak experience. So get used to this peak experience you're having. Get used to this peak experience. And don't be immediately thinking about what other peak experiences you might be having or could be having. Full stop in this peak experience. Fully get used to the fact you just made this tremendous traverse, tremendous step. And that's all you can do right now. You did the utmost right now. And then get used to this and normalize it for yourself. Normalize it for yourself. So that you feel, this is where I am now. This is where I dwell. This is where I abide. Where I am, there is no doubt. Where I am, there is no doubt. And then say, this is the full extent of my conceptualization. Where I am, there is no doubt. That's it. No more conceptualization is needed. just that. The only thing we miss out with this rain is that there's no birds. The birds are quiet. The only those birds are singing a little bit. I guess they quiet them down a little bit. I did just see a bird fly there, but they tend not to be so vocal. I don't know, where do birds go when it rains? I don't know. Birds are very good at concealment. It seems like all animals are very good at concealment. Where I am, there is no doubt. Where I am, there is no doubt. So again, when you reach a peak, a wow, which means a breakthrough, a peak experience, even if you've reached it before, it's more profound this time. That's where you stop. You immediately stop. And get used to it. Normalize it for yourself. So, for instance, for me in this instance, I would be saying, yeah, the roof is where I am. This so-called roof, and where I am on this roof, there is no doubt. This is where I am. This is where I am. This is where I am. This is my identity. This is the I. This is where I am. So I'm normalizing that. This is where I am. I'm on this flat, smoothed outness, where there is no down from it at all. There is no down at all from here. There is no downness. This is where I am. I'm not saying I'm someplace else, thinking about where else could I be, or where else was it? Where was I before? I'm not thinking about where was I before, or where might I be after this. Neither one of those, you see, neither one of those. This is where I am right now. That's all I'm thinking, that's all I'm considering. I don't need to think about it because I'm already here. You see, I'm on this roof, where I am, there is no down. So that's where I am, so I don't need to think about it. I'm here. I just need to get used to it in a sort of a holistic way. And if I just don't move, I'll stay here, right? By just not moving, I'm staying here. By not moving my mind, I'm staying here. If my mind moves to the past, then I don't realize where I am. If it moves to the future, I don't realize where I am. Where I am, there is no doubt. Don't get into thinking, oh yeah, that means a realization of the I. Okay, this reminds me of some book and thinking, no, stop. I'm here. That's all I need to know. Where I am, there is no doubt. I'm here. I'm already here. So just stay where you are. And that certainly includes the mind, the attention. See, the mind is attention. It's habits and patterns of attention is what we call thinking and thoughts. So just keep your attention on where you are. And then don't go into, yeah, that reminds me, that's mindfulness training. I think that's something. Now, who does mindfulness training? Is it, boom, you've forgotten where you are, just like that. So it's really important. Don't go on a spiritual trip. You see, as you go into phase four, you've gone through phase one, two, and three, you're probably very erudite spiritually, very intelligent, have a lot of experience. But what phase four is, you drop all of that. You stop linking up to all your spiritual knowledge. You have to drop all your spiritual concepts. You have to drop those. It's just where I am, there is no doubt. That's it. I don't need to know anything else other than that. This is where I am. This is where I dwell now. This is my dwelling. Where I am, dwelling, there is no doubt whatsoever. There is no doubt. Now, inherently, we know what this means. And what it means is really great. But we don't go chase after that greatness. Not now. It's like we made this cross. I mean, realize across this crevasse, and we realize from here on, there's a route up to the top. You know, like that. Because I know. Okay, fine. But we're not there right now. Right now, we're where we're at. We're tired. We made a big breakthrough. It's a shock. And it's a shock to realize that there's no really impediments to reaching the top now. See, there's no real impediments. It's like, wow, I'm going to succeed. Wow, no, stop that. It's the wow, okay? Just, where am I now? Oh, where I am, there is no down. Okay, where I am, there is no down. Don't search for meaning. The meaning's inherently there. Don't search for the feeling. The feeling's inherently there. It's just we're in a shock right now, so we're not feeling it so much. We're in shock. So recognize the shock. This is very key. What happens, the mind says, well, where's the bliss? And then it goes thinking, well, I must have done something wrong, or thinking, maybe I need to be somewhere else. No. And because of our continuity fear, our mind is staggered. We're shocked at the success we just had. Shocked. So what we're feeling is shock, really. And so we just have to let the shock wear off without struggling with the shock. Say, wait, where's my bliss? Where's my bliss? Where's my peace of mind? Where's my peace of mind? Now we have shock right now. So we don't say, well, wait, what kind of technique do I need to do? Do I need to, what kind of knowledge do I need to remember? Who said, Buddha said what? Or said, no, none of that. We're in shock because the continuity fear dropped all of that. It doesn't matter if the Buddha's on the roof with you or Jesus on the roof with you or whatever. No, don't even think about it. Don't even think about it. Who's on the roof with you? No, just I am. Where I am, there is no down. This is where I am. And it's shocking to me. So recognize the shock, the staggered mind, the wow, as I call it, the staggered mindness. Full stop in the now of the staggered mindness. Don't get into wow. The wow's already there. So don't get into trying to amplify it. Say, hey, I just reached this, you know, in non-dual realization. I just had this incredible. No, you already had the wow. So just stop with that. Don't try to amplify it. Very important. Do not try to amplify it. So in other words, be very gentle and smooth with where you're at in this shock. Now, you can return to it gently, return to it. But don't get into this frantic elation at all. Stay away from that. Stay away from the depression of it. Like, immediately go, no, where I am, there is no doubt. There is no down. There is no down. Where I am, there is no down. Now, of course, we know we're talking about bliss. Tacitly, there's inherently we understand, we recognize. It's always okay, goodbye. But I'm shocked. I'm shocked. Shocked at this success. Shocked at the success. But I accept it. So, meanwhile, have to get used to the shock of success. About other traditions, other spiritual paths, or nothing. No spiritual shop talk. That's very important to drop all that. So there's a part of your mind as you get to the fourth stage that is very, again, very knowledgeable, spiritually knowledgeable. That's the part of your mind you need to stay away from now and drop it. Don't go. Don't let yourself get pulled into that. Did you say, well, I know all sorts. I know a lot about this. That's what you have to stay away from and drop that. What, know a lot about being shocked, staggered mind right now, right here, me? No. We don't know anything about that than what we're experiencing, actually, right now. So it's our experience right now. Experiencing it is knowing it. Holding on to it is knowing it. So don't let it get taken away from you. And don't go into some other, oh, this sounds similar to, right away, you've lost it, drop it. Mine's very clever in this. See, the mind is looking for a downer, right? Because we're shocked, where I am, there is no down. So we're so used to having it down. The mind is looking for downers. And if you're following the mind that way, you won't realize where you are. You forget where you are. You'll be out of touch, disassociated with where you are. Where I am, there is no down. There are no downers. There is no downer. Where I am, there is no down whatsoever. And so I have to get used to this fact. And the mind isn't helping me get used to this fact when it's speeding off, looking for highs and downs and all this. Where I am, there is no down. And it's way more important to look at it that way than to say, where I am is really high. Now, where I am, there isn't any down whatsoever. No possibility of any down whatsoever. None. This is what's important. Don't try to say, how high am I? That's meaningless, because where I am, there is no down. There's no down at all. See, this is non-dual. So you must rest in the non-duality instead of conjuring up some great dualistic concept of where you are. Because the mind will do that, try to conjure up, oh wow, where you are is so great, it's like this. No, it's not like that. Forget about it like this. It's like this teaching, or like that teacher, or this is similar. No, where I am, there is no down at all. There's no like this at all. Duality is always saying, talking about non-duality. Saying, non-duality is like this. Drop, that's a concept. Non-duality is like this. Where I am, there is no down. Where I am, there is no down. And I'm here now. Now, you don't know what to say about it conceptually, right? Exactly. So, you cannot teach this. You can only get here, so to speak. Recognize where you're here. And then experience this, go through this shock and stabilize and normalize it. That's it. Truth is not something that is conceptually transmitted. It's something that is directly experienced. And it's only directly experienced when you're able to, as you move your comfort zone, your stability, your normalization, more and more and more and more and more, you're able to full stop. Then your awakening gets stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger, like this. Say, ah, where I am, there is no down. There is no down at all. And so this is the shock of shocks, because we're completely used to ups and downs, right? Totally used to ups and downs. And so it's almost like a vertigo, some kind of spiritual vertigo, where there's a way of looking at it. As you experience the shock, the staggered mind, it's also like the potential for extreme spiritual vertigo is there. Vertiginous situation. And so that is where this will, this discipline comes into play. Now, I went through about a month and a half of actual vertigo a while ago. How long ago? It was maybe a couple months ago, maybe. Where I was really getting into phase four strongly. And I was actually experienced severe vertigo in my body, actually. This was a reaction to getting into phase four. So, it is potentially very vertiginous, if that's a word. Not, we'll call it a word. Where there is no down. So we're so used to being in an up, down, up, down, up, down situation, right? When you feel, this is why you have to be very disciplined so you don't get into this mental vertigo over this. Because we're not used to it. We're not used to it at all. Now, it's difficult to talk about this. This is part of what I'm doing. It's difficult, very difficult. It's a lot easier just to do it in quiet. But having already done it, this helps. This helps as part of what my role is here, is to share this and encourage others. And it requires, you know, a lot of discipline to do this, to not get go into some sort of vertigo. I call them freak out. The mind can easily freak out. There is no down. One of the keys is don't make anything of it. Don't make anything of it. Okay? Here's another way of looking at it. Don't make anything of it at all. This is where I am. There is no down. Don't make anything of it. Quiet mind, still mind, not making anything of it whatsoever. Anything of it whatsoever, including not making anything of it that I'm not making anything of it, okay? Because that'll freak you out right there. So just hang loosely with it. Don't make anything of it. Just hang loosely with it. That's all. And don't make anything of hanging loosely with it, right? And having some humor is very helpful. Chuckling a little bit. Having some humor about it. Because that breaks up the freak out, the chain of thinking, the concatenation. I mean, the chain of thoughts, concatenation. You have to do. As soon as you see a concatenation taking place, chain of thoughts, drop it immediately. Don't find out where that will take you. Drop it. This is so important. You start having a scenario, you think, oh, this is a very important scenario talking about this. Now, how is this going to, where is this going to go? What can I get from this? Drop that meal, just drop it. This is making something of it, don't make anything of it. Anything of it. Where I am, there is no doubt. Don't make anything of it. Don't say, oh, this is really important. That's making something of it. Oh, this isn't important. That's making something of it. You already know it's important. See? So you don't need to, that's already part of tacitly, inherently known. Because it's wow. It wouldn't be a wow if it weren't really important. So it's already known. So you don't need, nothing more need be added. Nothing be added or subtracted. Hang loosely. Don't make anything of it, including that, hey, I'm not making anything of it. Immediately you made something of it. Right? Wow, look at me, I'm not making anything of this. That's great. Whoops, drop it. Drop it. We're trying to become elated about it, though. We're in shock. So don't try to superimpose or push elation upon shock. That's when the trouble comes. Don't try to become non-elated about it, right? Don't try to push yourself down or up. Where I am, there is no down. There is no down whatsoever. Where I am, there is no down. now to be really helpful. Keeping this up for quite some time is very helpful. So you feel like you've really gone a long ways to normalizing this. Don't just break away from it. Don't have a clock on your full stop in the wow, in the now of the wow. Don't have a clock on it. Don't be timing yourself. And don't be saying, well, hey, I've done this for a long time. I'm really doing great, you know? Don't make anything up. Remember, your continuity issue is more severe than you realize. Because where I am, there is no down. Where I am is, there is no down. Where I am is, there is no down. Where I am is, there is no down whatsoever. And we are totally accustomed to there being downs, ups and downs. So this is just a radical, radical shift. And of course we're going to have a continuity issue with this. Of course. It's automatically we know this. We don't even need to think about it. We just need to stabilize ourselves intensely. Good little rain we're getting. Very nice. It's good. It's still November, right? It's today the 30th. Yeah, 30 days, so it's the last day of November. And getting a nice, good rain in the end of November is that really good for us. That's great. Hopefully December will be real rainy December, and we get rolling in to get the rainy season started early. We could use about 40 or 50 inches this year. Would be great. We'll pay for it. We'll have to pay for it. I mean, we've had like over 2 years of like immaculately beautiful weather here. Best weather I've ever experienced. It's just it's been absolutely incredible. Every day, almost every day, it's just been gorgeous and beautiful for like 2 straight years. Over 2 years. You just get up and you know the day is just going to be incredibly beautiful as far as weather-wise. And so, you know, we can afford to pay for that now by, you know, 5 months of rain. You know, let there be 5 months of rain. Gotta pay for it. But it's been quite an experience. It's been a drought, but just experiencing this incredible weather, unbroken, has been really an amazing experience here in California, I'll tell you. This has been shocking and stunning. It's been like, even in the wintertime, every day it's just so clear and beautiful and it's just, wow. And it helps you realize that you can dwell in a place where it's the atmosphere is peaceful and beautiful and calm, serene every day. You can. Of course, in this world, it results in a drought. But the idea that gets into you, no down. Where I am, there is no down. Where I am, there is no down. Where I am is, there is no down. California can be a blessing or a curse. It depends how you use it. Depends how you use it. If you take it spiritually, it's a blessing. If you take it physically, dualistically, physically, then it can be a curse because it can waste your time also. Because you can think, oh, it's a great day. I just want to spend all day out there recreating and busy, you know, stuff. Whereas you say, oh, it's a beautiful day. I'm going to sit here and meditate all day and just feel the vibe. Then it can be a blessing, actually. That takes discipline. A lot of people in California are very undisciplined now, actually. Babylon. Yeah, it's Babylon. They're frantically trying to bottle it, you know. Frantically trying to bottle it. Create a utopia, their utopian getaway, bottle it. That's the mistake. But for the last two plus years, you could not have had better weather. Could not have had better weather in this world, really. It's just been incredible. So it's like, what is this? Very different. What are we, in Europe? What, in Switzerland or something? Cloudy skies and rain? Must be in Europe or something. This isn't California. That's how you feel like that. What is this? It's weird. It shows you what you get used to and normalize. It feels normal to you, and then when something different comes, you say, well, that's really weird. It feels that way. It feels like a rainy day is very weird here now. Very abnormal. So you can see, when we get used to, whatever we get used to, even if it's the belief in ups and downs, that becomes normal for us. And so when we get in the roof of, now we're sitting in this, where I am, there is no down at all. This seems like really weird. Really weird. So it's a shock and a weirdness both. The shock is, wow, I know this is super profound. And then there's a weirdness that comes with it. So this is, I'm not used to this. This seems very abnormal. Very abnormal. So the shock and the weirdness of it is unavoidable. It's unavoidable. See, the mind keeps thinking that conceptually it can handle this conception. It cannot. This is the trap. Because we're dealing with a familiarity issue. It's like, let's say, okay, we've had all this sunshine for 2+ years, and now it's raining. So let's say someone stays in their room and says, it's raining outside. Okay, and they say, okay, rain. Okay, what is rain? Rain is precipitation. Precipitation is wet. There will be moisture on the leaves, there's moisture on this, everything. The precipitation is coming from clouds. The clouds are coming from a front that is moving through here. And you see, on and on, this is all thinking. Meanwhile, they're in the room, and they're not experiencing the rain at all. At all. Whereas coming out, I'm outside here now, I'm experiencing, I feel the moisture, feel the dampness, I'm seeing the rain, everything, directly experiencing it all. And it says, oh, this is weird. I'm feeling that weirdness and getting used to it. This is how the path goes successfully. Not the whole conceptualization thing. That takes place in phase 1 and 2 and 3 to some extent. And in phase 4, you have to drop all that. You have to experience it. Now, of course, during phase 2 and 1, 2, 3, you're also gradually doing that bit by bit. Absolutely, just phase 4 is more intense. That's all. It's way more intense. And you have to be way stricter, more disciplined. Because the weirdness and the shock is stronger. You don't want the vertigo to start up. And it won't, as long as you stay disciplined. What happened was I pushed myself maybe too strongly because of dire circumstances I was in, and still am in, but that may have caused the vertigo, and tried to force things a little bit too much. So it's possible to go a little too fast if you're trying to force things too much. Just back off a little bit, not much, just a little bit. If you have heartburn, just skip a meal. You know, let it settle down. You don't have to stop eating forever. Just skip a meal, maybe. But many of us are in dire circumstances right now, myself included. And you can certainly recognize where I am. Where I am is, there is no down. Where I am, there is no down. Where I am, there is no down. Obviously, when we can normalize in this and accept it, and then just stop there, drop that, because you can see the connection with dire circumstances, okay? You realize, what are dire circumstances? Ups and downs, you're on a down phase. Where I am, there is no down. You realize, wow, okay, wow. But don't try and apply it like a tool to your dire circumstances. No, because where I am, there is no down. In order to be saved, you only need to hold on to what is true. You don't need to work on what is not true. Where I am, there is no down. I don't need to work on anything that's down. There is no down. Just hold on to what is true. If you want to be saved, hold on to what is true. If you want to be saved from the hell of falsity, just hold on to what is true. Don't go to work on what is false. Hold on to what is true. So that's why we have to normalize where we are. Don't conceptually say, okay, I just recognize the truth, I'm going to go work on falsity and change it and fix it and heal it. No, that's the trap. That's the dualistic trap. That's the trap right there. I'm going to defeat downness because I know there's no down. So now I'm going to go work on the downness and defeat it and make sure there's right in the dream again. You've just suddenly gone back to hallucinating. Where I am, there is no down. Again, don't apply it to anything. This is the trap. It goes right back into dreaming. And this is the trap that trips so many up in phase 1, 2, and 3. So you don't get into phase 4 unless you have been able to let go of a lot of this trapness of trying to apply it to anything. Your insights. Don't try to apply your insights to the world. Don't try to fix the world. There isn't any world. There is no down. Where I am, there is no down. Where I am, there is no world. Where I am, there is no down whatsoever. This is called waking up from the dream. So you don't go back in the dream and say, oh, good, I'm going to now, you know, iron out the downs. It's like a shirt that's perfectly smooth. There's not a wrinkle. With this shirt, there is no wrinkle. Where I am, there are no wrinkles. Where I am, there is no down whatsoever. Where I am, there is no down. This is where I am. So you don't then go back into dreaming of a shirt that's all wrinkled and says, okay, now I think I know how to iron out this shirt. This shirt's supposed to be smooth, so I'm going to iron it out. Back into delusion, back into duality, back into dreaming, just like that. Just like that. Falling back asleep. Remember Adam and Eve, they fell into a deep sleep, deep sleep where they're dreaming, and they haven't woken up yet. And this just talks about in duality, dream of good and bad, up and down, wrinkles. Okay. Where I am, there is no down. So I don't need to go into a dream and iron out any wrinkles, right? to make it so, or to keep it so. There simply isn't any doubt at all. This is what it is. This is where I am. This is what it is. So I don't need to work to keep it that way. I don't need to figure out how I established that. I didn't establish it. I didn't create it. I didn't establish it. I'm not sustaining it. So I neither created it, nor am I sustaining it. It is what it is. It's the will of God, actually. I didn't create the will of God. I'm not sustaining the will of God. So I need to do nothing except this is where I am. See, we've been trying to be greater than God, so we think that this we say, oh yeah, well this smoothness is this, no downness is there, but see, now how did I establish this again? How did I create this again? I kind of missed a link. I forgot. Oh, I forgot something. And then you could dive back into the dream. I must have forgot. So you realize where I am, there is no down. And then something the mind says, I'm forgetting. There's something I'm forgetting. What's that? Well, how did I establish this again? I forgot. Don't entertain that. Don't entertain the mind like that. Drop it. And the mind will also say, I'm a little bit nervous. Why? Well, how am I going to keep it this way? How do I sustain this? I can't remember how. I need to remember how I established this in order to know how to maintain this state. You know, I didn't establish it. I don't maintain it. God does. See, I didn't create God. I didn't create God. So this is the will of God I'm experiencing. There is no doubt in the will of God. There is no doubt in the will of God whatsoever. The will of God never goes down. The will of God never goes down at all. Not even in the tiniest bit. There's never been the slightest instance where the will of God goes down in the slightest bit. So these are the tricks the mind is playing on us. I think I forgot something really important. See, oh great! You reached the state of there is no down. I ain't where I am, there's no down. That's tremendous, the mind will say. That's really great. Yeah. And then I'll say like, okay, I feel like I this is great, but I feel like it's a little bit incomplete because I'm forgetting something. It's a little bit incomplete. I'm forgetting something. How did I get this? How did I establish this? How did I create this? This is what the trick. This is what the mind is playing off. Okay, drop it. Just laugh, have a chuckle. Just drop it. And again, it will say, how do I sustain this? No, this is really great you're here. The mind will say, this is really great we are here. And now, how do we sustain this again? I mean, I think I know. And what did Buddha say about sustaining this? What did Jesus say about sustaining this? What did Ramana Maharshi say? I think Ramana said something about, I can't quite remember what Ramana said about this. Or is it just a vibe? But see, you're worrying about how to sustain it. Meaning, there's a down to it. Where I am, there is no down. Is no down. So there's no possibility of me sustaining this. There is no question of sustaining. There isn't any down. So there's nothing to sustain. Nothing to sustain. There's no down. I can't go down from this. I cannot go down from this. It's impossible. So the issue of sustaining is not even there. See, the issue of sustaining is not even there. And I didn't create this at all. I didn't establish or create this. So the issue of how did I do this is not there either. Neither of those issues are there. They're both completely bogus issues. Dualistic issues, right? Dualism is how did I create God and how do I sustain God? This is the root of dualism, actually. The root of dualism is how did I sustain God and how did I create God and how do I sustain God? And the play of this is what is this nightmare of what they call samsara, or the ocean of conditioned existence, the ups and oceans of ups and downs, of waves and troughs and chop, and the ocean of ups and downs. It's completely fake, completely bogus, totally fake. We didn't create God, and we're not sustaining God. So we don't have the question of how do I stay here? There is no down from it. Where I am, there is no down. There's no question of sustaining it, and I didn't create it. So there's no question of how did I create it in order to figure out how to sustain it. So the problem is say, well, how do I sustain it? And immediately we start thinking, okay, in order to sustain it, I gotta remember how I created it. So this is what pulls us back into dreaming. And we're suddenly on this ocean of samsara, and there are these huge waves. Toss about, you know, ups and downs. Wow. Okay, I gotta figure out now. You know, how did this lead to? How did I out of this ocean ups and downs? How did I smooth it out and stabilize it? How do I stabilize it? No, where I am, there is no down. There's never been a down. There is no down. There is no down. There's not a question of stabilizing. How did I stabilize the ocean of samsara? Ocean of ups and downs. I didn't, because that's just a dream. That's a hallucination based on the belief that I created God, you see. Where I am, there is no doubt. See, now the rain is letting up a little bit. Just like this, I'm getting more used to this. Where I am, there is no doubt. So the intense stress, the rain pouring down, is now it's lightening up, okay? Lightening up a little bit. And there's been another wow, which is I just understood the root of duality. We just shared it here. This is the root of duality, what we just expressed. That is a big wow too. So another wow has sort of come up. Progress. We'll stop with that. Another challenge. Don't make anything up. First thing, full stop, don't make anything up. So the ordeal repeats itself. But, welcome to the path. It's wonderful, it's great. Wonderful, great. Because we know we're leaving that ocean behind, that terrible ocean. Sometimes it seems placid, and then suddenly the waves come. We don't trust it, do we? This great ocean of ups and downs. We try to find a safe harbor. We think we found some. Oh, it's calm now. It's great. We pray, please let it stay calm. Please let it stay calm. We're all worried. And then there's some wind. And there's some clouds. And so, oh, before you know it, a storm comes. And the ocean is just chaotic. And we're plunged into this ups and downs. And we've been going through this so long. And this ocean, we just said, God, how do we stabilize this ocean? God, we pray to God. God, please help us stabilize this ocean. And it never stabilizes. And we say, God must not exist. God won't stabilize the ocean for us. It's terrible. And now we realize the whole situation, right? Wow. See, the video yesterday was samsara is fake. This ocean is completely fake. Totally fake. And now today, we've gone further to realize the whole root of duality. And so this is a bigger wow. Like, wow. Where I am, there is no down. Where I am, there is no ocean of ups and downs at all. None. Doesn't exist. Never has existed. Never will exist. Never will exist. Now, in phase four, we've done so much work in phase one, two, and three. We realize I deserve this realization. Yeah, I deserve it. So I just take it in stride. So the wow is not overwhelming. There's a problem, a big problem in rushing the path. Some techniques try to, you know, produce a breakthrough. But you will say, you know, like, I don't know if I really deserve this, really. You know, there's a feeling like, do I really deserve this? You know, and then that will throw you back and freak you out. But if you really put in the work, you've really put in the work, and you know that you've been focusing on this for a long time, and you're used to focusing on it, it's normal for you to have success. Then you say, yeah, I deserve this for sure. Whereas if you haven't really put in much work on the path, it's not normal to you, this kind of success. You say, wow, is this normal? I'm not sure this is normal. What did I do to get this? You let go, you drop it. I'm not sure if this is normal for me or not. So the path is frustrating because you'll have it and then you drop it, you let go of it. But for me now, it's like I was thinking yesterday, do I really deserve, you know, to succeed? And I said, absolutely I do. Absolutely I do. This would be normal for me to succeed. Very normal. So in the stage four is when you feel success is normal for you. You deserve to succeed. You expect to see you deserve it. It's normal. You feel it's normal. So if I were to go into this, you know, where I am, there is no down, and just stay in that. Is this normal? Will be normal? Yes, 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 yes. There might be a little cough there of disagreement. But I have to get normal. I have to get used to that it is normal. So there has to be a normalization that it is normal. Don't make anything of it. So when you cannot make anything of it, yeah, where I am, there is no doubt. Not make anything of it. Oh, yeah, the root of samsara, the root of delusion, the root of duality is, how did I create God and how do I sustain God? And that tries to pull us back into the dream, delusional dream of ups and downs. And you say, yeah, it's normal for me to get this. Don't make anything of it. I expect it. I say, yeah, I've seen this many times, bit by bit. So it's normal for me to see this, to recognize this. It's normal recognition for me. So I feel normal about recognizing this. Whereas, you know, 20 years ago, I remember I made a video of me recognizing in time and space and how it didn't exist and everything. And I was like jumping up and down and celebrating and hollering and, wow, Eureka! You know, it's like the biggest deal. But then I lost it, you see. That was back in, you know, 1998, so, no, 15 years or more, okay, maybe, so, but now, I get to see this even way more clearly, seeing how it all fits together, and I just say, yeah, this is normal, it's no big deal, don't make anything up, but feeling-wise, of course I feel it's a big deal. But I'm used to feeling that it's a big deal. I'm used to wows, 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 wows. So this wow is, oh yeah, every day is wow, 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 wow. That's normal. But you still have to be disciplined. It's also normal. Don't make anything of it. Going into the future is making something of it, right? So don't project in the future like, oh, I'm going to have this great monastery and everybody's going to come there, I'm going to be enlightened about it. No, don't go into the future. That's making something of it. Don't make anything of it. Don't make anything of it. I'm just a nobody from nowhere. And don't make anything of that either. Ups and downs is all completely fake. The ocean of ups and downs is totally fake. Totally fake. It's just a dream. It's an imagining. Totally unnecessary imagining. Totally unnecessary fake. Totally unnecessary mirage. A totally unnecessary illusion. A totally unnecessary hallucination. The ocean of samsara, as they say in Buddhism and Hinduism, is totally fake, totally unnecessary. The ocean of samsara is a total mirage. The ocean of samsara is a total illusion. The ocean of samsara is a total hallucination. It's absolutely, the ocean of samsara is not even the slightest bit. Now here comes the rain again. Here comes the wow again, right? Great. Great. Progress. Don't make anything up. Don't let elation creep in. Don't let this feeling of elation jubilation. Don't let it creep in. Just don't make anything up. It's already a big deal. You know, don't try to add on to it. Don't get greedy. Don't get greedy. Stop in the wow. You know, don't add on. Once you really, you know, push in the new territory, tremendous. Wow, I see the whole thing. It's just don't get greedy. Just stop. Stop. I remember the time I was in non-dual violence, and I just said, okay, I'm a non-dual violence. That's great. And I said, okay. And I know, okay, I see it. I'm experiencing it. But I'm going to full stop. I'm going to sort of back away just a little bit intentionally. So I don't try to make a big deal about it. It was like that. You're going through the jungle. You come out. You come outside and there's a spectacular vista. There's the Congo in the jungle. The river, just this incredibly massive, powerful, serene river. You've been going through the jungle for years. You get to this, and you see it. And then, if you're smart, if you're spiritually aware, you say, "Okay, I know the river's here. I know where it is. I know it's stupendous, and I know it's going to overwhelm me. I'm going to intentionally back up a little bit back into the jungle, and then just sit down and just calm down." And that's what I did. So the awareness is already there. So you just sit in the jungle, and then every day you get up and you walk and take a few steps closer to the opening in the jungle where there's the Congo River. Don't think about the Congo, just normalize, because you already know it's there. So you just get used to this knowing. Next day you get a little closer, next day a little closer. Finally you get like real close where you can kind of see it through the foliage now. Don't rush out to it. You say, "I know it's there. I just sit here and be quiet and still and feel very normal where I am. Oh yeah, this is where I live." Someone asks you where you live. "Well, I live right on the edges of the Congo here. I can see it right through the foliage. It's right there." Yeah. And just ho-hum. You can, get used to this. "Oh, ho-hum. Yeah, this is where I live now." And the next little later, you get a little closer where there's a tree here, a tree here, and there's the Congo. You just stop right there. See, this is where I live. You get used to it. This is where I live. Oh yeah, I live on the banks of the Congo. There's a tree here and a tree there. I can see the Congo flowing there in the distance. This is where I live. Yeah, that's all. Just get used to that. Just get used to that. This is where I live. Don't make anything of it. This is where I live. Yeah, this is where I live. A little later, you put a little bench on the bank and you're looking out or something. You're overlooking the Congo. Every day I go sit on the bench overlooking the Congo for several hours, just directly seeing it again. Yeah, that's where I live. That's my lifestyle. Just get used to that lifestyle. That's it. Don't make anything of it. It becomes your lifestyle. And there is my lifestyle. This is where I live and this is my lifestyle. Okay, so you see how great that is. This is the path to success. The other is come out through years of struggling through the jungle and camping in the jungle, and you come out upon the Congo and it's open space, mighty river, stillness. It's just like awesome space open. And you just like have this complete peak experience. You say, wow. You say, I'll remember this the rest of my life. And you turn around, go back in the jungle, and go back home. You see? And then you write books about it. Took pictures. You take pictures of the Congo. You go home. You write books. My adventures in the Congo. Coming upon the Congo River. How I had a peak experience. You give seminars. You give conferences. You become famous. People know you as, yeah, this is the one that had the peak experience that came upon the Congo in the middle of the jungle and gave it. Yeah, wow. Really, this is amazing. Can I have your autograph? Can you sign my book? This is wonderful. You know? Okay, that's okay, that is what it is, right? And the other way is now you're living on the banks and you spend this time sitting over, suspended over this river, just absolute stillness, absolute spaciousness, absolute peace. That's your lifestyle. That's your lifestyle. All because you backed off of it and said, whoa, wait a minute. I want to be here permanently, so I'm going to approach this gradually now. I know it's there. My goal is just permanent, to stay here, not to go back to civilization and be famous. Forget that. So where I am, there is no down. See, the jungle is ups and downs of everything. Where the Congo is all smooth, it's level, right? There's just a massive levelness of this river. And the quietness and the peacefulness and the lakes. Oh, the levelness of it is so fabulous. Here I am tripping over roots for years, stumbling through this rainforest of roots and vines and nothingness even. Nothing. It's all ups and downs. Yes, my God, and now I'm looking up, this is just, it's totally smoothness. It's total smoothness. But because you've been on this path, blessed by all those, by the grace of God and all those who have gone before, and you've been wise, you immediately recognize, hey, wait a minute, I have a severe continuity fear. I'm going to manage this continuity fear, so I'm going to back off a little bit, potentially, and sit down, and then work with this continuity fear. See, that's the difference between success and failure. The other doesn't recognize the continuity fear. They try to stay there as long as possible. Suddenly, they feel this enormous urge to return to civilization and tell everybody about it. And they turn around, and they go back through the jungle, and they're gone, you see. And they think, oh, I'm being a hero. I'm going to be famous. It's all. That is the continuity fear speaking. That's unrecognized continuity fear. Wham! Hits you. So what we do is we preempt that entirely. We immediately recognize, peak experience, continuity fear. I'm going to back off a little bit. Sit down, normalize. Normalize who I am now. And gradually we get up to it. So while they're out writing books, going on tours, and holding conferences, and being one of the speakers at these big conferences, and all these spiritual people show up and say, yeah, you know, I want to tell you about this peak, how this peak experience, and how it happened, and how incredible it was, and how it's transformed my life, and how spiritual I feel now, and how I feel like we're all one. We have the possibility of all becoming one. We have the possibility of smoothing out the world, this ocean of samsara. We can smooth it out because I've seen smoothness I feel is possible. Instead of doing that, you're like, You're sitting through the foliage. You're seeing the condo. You're seeing the swings. You're right there. You're getting used to it. So this is normal for me. I'm not making anything of it. This is my life. Feels normal. So they're having a big career back in the world and making all sorts of money and fame, and they know all these celebrities, and you know, the celebrities come and talk to them. And, yeah, well, I know them. I know this guru, this teacher. And, you know, meanwhile, nobody knows you. You even exist. Nobody even knows you exist. And yet, here you are, and say, yeah, this is where I live. This is normal for me. Here's a tree here, and a tree here, and a tree here, and I'm moving right here. And right over there is the Congo. I can see that, and the smoothness, the vast river. This is where I live. This is normal for me. And remember, this whole jungle is a mirage. Doesn't exist. And all this civilization back behind the jungle is a mirage. It doesn't exist. It's an illusion. It's an hallucination. And so as you're living there on the banks of the Congo, you see various people come through the jungle. See it, and say, oh my God, and they go back to civilization. You know, they come. Occasionally someone will come up to it, look, and then just back off and say, wait a minute, just sit down. Then you know those are the ones that know. Those are the ones that nothing need be said about. So, how do you get to be one of those ones? Is it, well, there are those who are. It's normal, completely normal for them. And they convey this truth back to us. We are struggling through the jungle. They say, hey, there's a river, a huge river. When you come up through the jungle, you will go, eventually you're going to see this. And we want to prepare you for seeing this. So this is the training you need to have. When you see this, you need to back off a little bit because you have a continuity fear. So you already know. You get this teaching. So you know what to do when you get there. Because why? Fame is not that important to you. So how am I able to do this? And I can tell you that in the life just previous to this one, I was very famous, super famous. And I said, okay, been there, done that. That's not my goal. My goal is not to be famous. My goal is realization. Get free of this ocean of samsara. Because let me tell you, if you want a choppy ocean of samsara, of ups and downs, well, just try being super famous. And you will experience how that is. And you will say, no, 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 no. In this life, I said, I want to be a nobody from nowhere. And don't I want any friends? I don't, quote unquote, friends. When you're super famous, everybody's your friend. You know. They all want a piece of you. I don't want to be a nobody from nowhere. I don't want any friends. I just want to be a recluse, basically. I want to be a recluse. So I've been a recluse my whole life. And I want realization. I want it permanent. You know. So this is how I did it. This is how I'm doing it. The others are still chasing fame. They say, wait a minute. I can be famous for seeing this. I had a peak experience. I can go back and sell this. You know, and a lot of people are. It's a vast marketplace in this world of all these people who have peak experience selling spirituality. Vast marketplace out there. And I looked at that and said, no. Forget it. Even spiritual fame is a real bummer. Yeah. Unless the only way you can really deal with it is realize there are no doubts. Sri Sri Anandamayi is a perfect example of being able to deal with it effortlessly. Everyone wanted a piece of her. If you talk about the ocean of samsara swirling about her, didn't faze her in the slightest bit, not in the slightest bit. But that's very rare, very rare. And she said that in her case, she never ever hallucinated or fell into the hallucination of duality. It never even happened. It's not like she had fallen into it and gotten free of it. You've never been in it at all. So it was just completely natural for her to function the way she did. 100% natural. No experience of it ever being otherwise. It's super rare in this world. It's called an avatar, so it's super rare. So, but it shows you it is possible. Absolutely is possible. In other words, all this fame didn't bother her at all. But for most of us, it's the worst thing. It's the worst thing. The blessing is to be a recluse. That's the blessing. So this teaching, I'm giving it out, this teaching, sharing out this teaching, because this is the way. This is the way. It is for those who want to truly succeed, permanent, realizing it's always been permanent. I didn't create the permanency. I'm not sustaining the permanency. There's no way that it can be anything other than permanency. Permanency, I am, is permanent, inherently so. Everything else is just an illusion. So chasing after fame in the ocean of ups and downs, ocean of duality, ocean of samsara, that's a real drag. That's a real drag. And there's some people who play the game very well, you know, and they seem so happy, they always slide. I'm wondering why all these people, you know, in the symposiums, conferences, the whole game of spirituality is going on in the world. They're always smiling, they always have photos of them, you know, super happy. I even put up a picture of myself like that. It just for fun, you know. Why are you doing this all? I'm so happy, you know. I was okay. You're on the path. You're really on the path. It's not fun and games. It's an ordeal. You're not. The real gurus oftentimes are not smiling at all. Those are Ramana Maharshi. Here's my photo. I can't even do it. I can't even do it. Well, sometimes he might have had a little smile, but mostly, you know, just it's in the eyes, it's in the presence. There is no ocean of samsara for Ramana. It doesn't exist. He didn't free himself from the ocean. He didn't cross the ocean. He didn't stabilize the ocean. He knows the ocean doesn't exist. It's never existed. He just stopped hallucinating and believing in the hallucination. Realize nothing needs to be done. Nothing needs to be done. And so you see this vast peace. Doesn't need to smile. It's the vast peace. So we have this down this road. Gosh darn, I'm happy. And I'm going to help you be happy too, believe me. Just y'all come here and do the seminar. We're gonna be really happy together. That's great. That's fine. That's where they're at. That's where they're at. That's part of the... That's a phase. That's a phase. But it's slow boating. It's very slow. It's kind of tiresome running back through the jungle, back and forth. Yeah, some of them say, yeah, I've made like, you know, 5 trips through the jungle to the river. Wow, and each time, you know, it's been amazing. 5 trips, you know, wow. Everybody say, whoa, that's incredible. You're one of the greats, huh? And they say, well, yeah, you know, one of the greats. I made 5 trips, each time they left, you know, left. That's too much, I left. They're still in like, you know, phase one or something. Again, it's all good. It's all good. They'll realize that. They'll realize it. They'll get clued in after making all those jokes. They say, hey, wait a minute. Maybe I don't, next time I know I'm not going, I'm going to play it differently here. And then this is where they start getting clued into, you know, continuity problem is the only problem there is. Get tired of the fame. Maybe their next life. You know, they'll get down to business. The intoxication of being a spiritual leader is very intoxicating. So it grabs a hold of a lot of us. Now, in my previous life, I was not a spiritual leader. I was like a cultural leader. So, having had fame around all this and all the intention, everyone thinks you're like super, you know, like some higher, great higher person or something, way greater than them. And you realize how terrible that is. So, for me, I said, I don't want fame of any kind. I don't want spiritual fame either. It's all the same, you know. So, I've sidestepped it. Even on this channel, you know, very few views. What I get, 25, 40 views per video or something, that's it. So it's just a little tiny something, you know. But, you know, that's fine. At some point, you know, you become known when you like, you feel like Ramana Maharshi, you're going to become known at some point. But what's important is to sidestep all this rigmarole, the circus, the spiritual circus that's going on in the world. So that's what you want to sidestep. Which I've done a very good job of it. Very good job of it. It hasn't been easy at all. Because I see all these people out there, you know, and I say, well, I know more than they do. I've had way more peak experiences and everything. And they're out marketing all this stuff and being successful and glamorous and everything. And you see, like, huh. I can't do that, is it? But no, I don't really want to do that. So let's just keep going. Just keep going here. So, and the Holy Spirit always told me, don't pay any attention to all the spiritual people. I said, well, wait a minute. You know, I know so much, Holy Spirit. And these people out there, they're making all these mistakes. And I realize that they're making these mistakes. I can do better than that. And the Holy Spirit says, don't pay any attention to, for instance, the Holy Spirit always told me, don't pay any attention to those who are teaching A Course in Miracles. I said, don't pay any attention at all. Forget it. So pretty much I didn't. I didn't pay any. Try not to pay any attention, you know. I've noticed that such and such is publishing books about this and getting on Oprah and all these kind of things. And Holy Spirit says, forget it. Don't pay any attention. Just keep going. Faster. Faster. And Jesus too says the same thing. Just go faster. Don't worry about any of that. That's not your thing. That's not your thing. Forget it. And so I did. I pretty much just paid no attention to what anyone else is doing. Just paid no attention to it. And so that's pretty much what I've done, is just pay no attention to what anyone else is doing as much as possible. You can be just sort of occasionally just notice, so this, okay, then just drop it. Okay, fine, drop it. Don't let it go any further than that. Because if I did, I said, well, I could write 100 books and 100 more and 100 more and, you know, just publish. Well, instead of practice. The Holy Spirit says practice. The Holy Spirit says don't publish. Practice. We have more than enough books that have been published. As Rishri Anandamayi said, don't build more temples. Because everybody wanted to build temples. See, here in the West, in this modern age, everybody wants to publish. I think there's some list of the 100 most influential spiritual people in the world put out by some bookstore in London, you know. And you look at them all of them, what is it they all have in common? They've all published. If you haven't published, you don't exist spiritually according to this bookstore. And so, it's all about publishing. And so they rate all these states, 100 most spiritually influential people in the world. It's all very much about publishing. How viable are you as a publisher? How many books have you sold? Well, this one is number 5 in the world because they've sold, you know, 50 million books worldwide. Published.